Hey everybody, Patrick here with Rap Ford. It's November 12th, 2012, and this is Monday Night Paintball. We got a great week of videos for you. I am swimming in footage to share with you guys. First, we're gonna see the 468 do some amphibious operations, and then you can expect a video on the 468 torture test, and I mean torture. We were amazed at what this thing can handle. And first things first, on this episode of Monday Night Paintball, I want to tell you about my weekend. Now, on Saturday and Sunday, myself and three other Rap 4 employees went down to Southern California to link up with Savoy 6, our flagship team. On Saturday, we attended a private MagFed game at an undisclosed location. Now, this was on private property, so I can't tell you where, but it was in kind of the mountains and hills around LA, and it was surprisingly cold. We were actually freezing out there, and so was the paint. We had a lot of barrel breaks, actually. No chamber chops, no magazine breaks, but coming out of the barrel, we had to actually reduce our feet per second so that we could get our shots out. Unfortunately, we were spraying paint for the first round or so. But it was cool watching Savoy 6 test out not only the MKP2, but the D-Mags and the 468. We actually brought out the torture test model, and they were able to play a few games with it, even considering everything it had been through. Once again, Mario got his hands on one. Mario of Savoy 6, you see him featured in the original 468 field test over at Operation End War 3. He's a really big guy with the Savoy 6 tattoo on the inside of his arm. He ended up getting his hands on that torture test model, and he had a really good time. Here's a couple clips of the action. On Sunday, we went to SC Village, and that's in Corona, California. Now, this is one of the most elaborate paintball fields I've ever seen. They have it quartered off into different sections. Each section has its own theme. We were lucky enough to get their airsoft field for the morning. Their only rule was that we use the powder rounds, or Rep 4 inert rounds, on it because they don't want to mess it up. This field's extremely elaborate. It looks like a Middle Eastern marketplace or something like that. They got a couple palaces in there, two-story buildings, staircases. It's pretty crazy. It was a lot of fun. Now, the highlight of the day for me was the final mission where Anthony from Savoy 6 actually charged right ahead using the MKP2 and D-Mags, and I think he eliminated about half of the other team. Now, the teams were about 10 people each, but it was really cool to see him just get in behind the enemy, start shooting in the back and in the sides. It's pretty amazing, and it was really cool seeing the D-Mags perform as well. Now, to answer some of the questions about the Rap 4 468 amphibious operations video that was released on Monday, just want to let you know that we were using Rap 4 inert rounds. Now, those are plastic shelled, powder filled 68 caliber projectiles. Those are completely waterproof. If you were going to try to do that with normal paintballs in your marker or your hopper or in your magazine, if you were to fill that with water, they would swell and dissolve and get gooey, and it would be a really big mess. So that's the only way we were able to do that, to test out the amphibious capabilities of the 468. Now, I do believe that first strike rounds have a plastic shell, so those should have done fine as well, but we did not test it that day. But obviously those are completely waterproof as well. Now, the 468 is completely amphibious. To answer some of your questions, it was underwater for a while, and you can see that in depth in the 468 torture test video coming out later this week. Alright, and on to some paintball news for you guys. Now, World Cup Asia is coming up, and it looks like 170 teams from 33 countries will be there. Now, on my recent trip to Rap 4 Malaysia, they were all talking about it. They were already getting hyped up, and that was, I don't know, maybe about a month ago. So it's a really big deal in that part of the world, and I know some pro teams around here that are really looking forward to it. It's going to be really cool. We're going to expect a lot of cool footage coming from there, especially from some of the pro teams that are there, having camera crews follow them around. It's a huge event, so be sure to check that out. Now, it looks like in the troubled area of Gaza in the Middle East, some teams were able to smuggle some paintball guns into there, and now they're charging about the equivalent of $2.50 to play. It's really amazing what lengths people will go to play paintball. Some people really love it. This one was actually probably pretty dangerous to get, but if you happen to be there, I'm not sure how many of our subscribers are over there, but if you're there, go ahead and check it out. It looks like it'll cost about 10 shekels for $2.50 to play. Now it looks like Russian Legion has signed up with Sly and Valken for 2013. They're going to be an official sponsored team by both of those companies. Now the Russians are one of the world's top paintball teams, and they'll be donning all Valken gear, so be sure to check them out for the latest Valken gear that hits the market. A few weeks ago, we mentioned a story from South Carolina where residents of a neighborhood put up signs warning speeding cars that if they don't slow down, their cars will be shot with paintball guns. Now, in New Zealand, one of the freeways is under construction and there's a detour going through a neighborhood, and one of the residents did the same exact thing. He put up signs warning cars to slow down or he was going to mark their windshields. And apparently, it's very effective. Now, some people say that the cars are just slowing down to read the signs. But either way, it's working, and I'm not sure if the mystery resident who put up those signs is watching the show, but if he is, thank you very much for subscribing.
All right, and that brings us to this week's tactical tip, which is pouch placement for your Molly vest. All right, this tip is thanks to Kusha, one of the members of our flagship team, Savoy 6. Now, Kusha has a lot of kit. His vest is decked out with pouches all over the place, and I make fun of him a lot for it, but he has a reason for everything he carries and he has a reason for where he puts it, so we thought this would be a good tactical tip this week. I'm going to be using this USMG vest in olive drab and these light colored pouches to show you kind of the contrast between what's the vest and what's the pouch. Now just a general rule of thumb when it comes to choosing where to put your pouches, this is very generalized, but you're going to want to put combat on the front, survival in the back. I'm going to break that down for you. Combat meaning ammunition, weapon systems, whether it's a pistol, some people like to put their pistol on their chest, grenades, knives, anything like that, anything you're going to take a life with, that goes on the front. In the back, you have survival stuff, medic pouch, water, okay, toolkit, and comms. Now the comms here, I put them back here, and there's a reason for that. I would not recommend this for most people. There's three elements when it comes to your radio that will determine which side you're going to put it on. First of all, are you mounted or are you on foot? If you're going to be getting in and out of a truck or a Humvee, you do not want to put your radio on your back because you're going to be mashing it against the seat when you sit down. If you're going to be on foot the whole time, it's very unlikely that your back's going to be touching anything. And while you're on foot, you need to keep that in mind, not to brush up against stuff. Also, just depending on the radio system. Two, what's your role in the platoon? Are you a platoon leader? Are you a radio transmitter operator? Do you need to be switching between different nets? You know, squad net versus jock net or whatever. You need to be bouncing around on different nets to talk to different people. If you do, you should probably have your radio somewhere where you can have eyes on it, have positive control, so you can see what channel you're on. Having it out of the way like this would be really detrimental. You need to be asking for a lot of help. So if you have a role where you're gonna need to have access to your radio to switch channels and stuff, you need to put that on your front. Third, I use a throat mic. Okay, if you have a throat mic or some kind of earpiece or something like that, this is a good spot for that, meaning that you have a push-to-talk button somewhere else on your person. If you don't, if you just have this radio just like this, then you're going to want to put it by somewhere on your weak side shoulder so it doesn't mess with your buttstock too much and you can reach over, talk to it. But I put it here for those three reasons. I am not bouncing between channels, I'm not getting in and out of vehicles, and I use a throat mic, so it's nice to have it out of the way. Now here on the front you can see this admin pouch up top. The reason why admin pouches are up top, there's three different reasons. First of all, they lay flat, so it's not going to mess with any pouches underneath. You still have eyes on these pouches down here, as well as access to them. If this admin pouch had some depth to it, you'd have trouble pulling these magazines out of this pouch. So it doesn't interfere with anything. Also, it has a large loop panel for unit identifiers, name tapes, or a flag, so it's nice up here, right where you expect a name tape to be, so you can identify each other quickly. Also, you can lift up this tab and you can look down in it. Maybe you have different documents. You don't want to pull everything out, try to sort through it. You just kind of want to see real quick. If it's a phone or something like that, you can see to make sure it's still on, stuff like that. So this is a really good spot for an admin pouch. You must always see them there. Here I have a carbine magazine retention pouch. Usually I prefer this kind. These tabs are really quick to get to. They don't get in the way. But if I'm going to be in a long battle or something like that, first of all, I usually reload from the hip. So speed off of my chest isn't a big deal to me. I don't always wear a vest, I always wear a belt. This is a system I'm setting up for if you did not have a belt, so I would be speed reloading for my chest. But like I said, if I was in a long battle, I'd have the, you know, the 2X ones, the ones with a double stack with the big the flap over the top, because I'm not really going to get to them that quick. But in this scenario, I put them here, these speed pouches here, just a standard loadout. You probably want to carry more than this, in which case I would suggest that you put it here on this side, mostly because if you're right-handed, that's your weak side. So you're going to want to be using that to reload your weapon system. If you have it on the right, now you have to kind of twist around and get to it, and it's all garbage. Also, be sure to point your magazines all in the same direction so that every time you reload, you're shifting a couple inches, not an entire, you know, method of getting it out of the pouch. Here I have two sidearm magazine pouches. Now this could be anything. If you have a pistol, or if the, you know, these can hold grenades, flashbangs, smoke, anything like that, this is a good spot for it. Also 203 shells if you're running a 203. This right here, this could be anything, like I said, as far as taking a life. This is a violent system right here. This is going to be something that you're going to use to get players out of the game, or you know, get people out of the fight. Okay, now here on the back, this camelback is pretty self-explanatory. I mean, they're designed to go on the back, the entire product here, with the straw to come around the front. Obviously, it goes to your back, but if you have another water system, canteens or something like that, you also want to put those on the back. Now, if you're going to use a canteen, and this is something that they found out probably in like World War I, you either are going to have a full canteen or empty canteen. Okay, you drink the whole thing. When you're going to take a drink of water, make sure that thing's empty, because you don't want the water splashing around in it. It actually gets pretty loud. It's gotten a lot of GIs killed over the years. So I put the water system back here. I run the straw underneath my arm, which means that the first drink of water you get is actually kind of hot. But I mean, after a day of running around on a paintball field, I mean, it's just gonna be hot anyway. But I put it there because it comes up underneath my mask so I can get to it real quick. That's my preferred method, but I see a lot of people drooping it over and they prefer to pull it up. Here I have a USMG small utility pouch. Now this is good for paintball, especially. This is where you can put your cleaning kit, your squeegee, something like that, anything you need to get to. Now, the reason it's in the back right here, not on my front, is because if I have to, you know, take my barrel out to swab it and everything like that, I'm already going to have to find a safe place to do this. I'm going to have to go take cover, let everybody know I'm out of the fight for a second, and go deal with this problem. I'm going to need to problem solve somewhere where the only problem I'm dealing with is what's in front of me, not what's going on around me. So that's, it implies that I have a moment to get to this. If I'm, my marker's in pieces, it means I have a second. So that's why that goes in the back. So this could be for anything also on the battlefield. I mean, you're talking about extra rounds, or perhaps, I mean, if you've got a shotgun, you can put shotgun shells in there, stuff like that. This right here, this pouch is gonna be very useful, but you may not ever get to it. If you do need it, you're gonna be glad you have it, but not necessarily in every situation. So I put it here just to get it out of the way. It also lies somewhat flat, so it's not gonna mess with my elbows when I'm running around. And over here, the medic pouch. This is a vital part of any kit. This is extremely important. Now, the reason it's in the back, you think that a medical kit you need to get to really quick, right? That's really important if you get hurt. Well, the thing is that you're never going to use your kit on you, okay? You're going to use the wounded person's kit on them. The reason for that is that if your buddy goes down, you grab the stuff out of your kit to help him, now you're missing a kit. If you go down, whoever helps you, they're gonna have to take out their kit to help you, and now it's this messed up game of musical chairs where, you know, it's who has equipment and who doesn't, and we don't want to play that. So you use the wounded person's kit on them, and that way there is one kit per person. Okay, so that's extremely important. You don't want to be caught without that stuff, especially if for some reason you're having the worst day ever and you're all by yourself, and now you have no, I mean, it's just game over for you. So I put this out of the way because I will never have to access this. This is for somebody else to use, not for me. Now at that point, I mean, I'm probably gonna be on the ground so they can roll me around and get to it. So this is out of sight, out of mind. You never have to worry about this, but if you ever come up to a wounded person, you need to find theirs. Now on the front, I've got a V-sling. I've explained it before. This mounts to the vest, to these D-rings back here, actually on the camelback. That's what I used. This is really nice because it eliminates one more strap around your person, being the rifle sling. Also eliminated a couple straps using this MOLLE Camelback. I like to get rid of the nonsense. I don't like to be in a big knot of tactical gear, especially, you know, when you trip and fall. It's pretty bad news. Now I'd like to take a second to talk to you guys about flashbangs in particular. You might have seen some pictures of SWAT team operators with flashbang pouches on their back, and there's a very specific reason for that. The way that a SWAT team works is much different than a military, than like a modern war fighter. Okay, SWAT team is not in a war. They're in a very tense situation that's also very controlled, okay? By the time a SWAT team shows up, there's most likely a perimeter set up around, you know, whatever situation there is. There might be a standoff. They know the building. They've got eyes on all directions. They probably have a lot of information on what's going in there, going on in there, and the situation in there is also very specific, okay? When you're a modern war fighter and you're walking around, you know, some town in some city in some country, you don't know what's going on, you need to have all this stuff with you as far as water, you know, med kits, toolkits, stuff like that. SWAT operators often use, you know, pistol caliber weapons, like MP5 or something like that, because they're trying to reduce the amount of collateral damage. They're in a very tense situation around innocent people versus something, you know, going on in the modern battlefield where you are trying to be as violent and effective as possible to get that person down and move on to the next one. So the reason that they have flashbangs on their back is because that's for their buddy. SWAT teams actually are extremely choreographed. They practice and practice and practice, okay? Even before they show up to a situation, they might have the blueprint of the building, at least the floor plan, so that they can go over it real quick. They have the luxury of having a very controlled situation. They're on those flashbangs are on the back so that the guy behind them in the stack can get to it and throw it in. That's the way that SWAT team, whatever picture you might have seen, that's how what they practice, and that's what works for them. Personally, I would prefer to have any kind of weapon system, even a flashbang, which is non-lethal, on my front so that I can get to it. Because, I mean, it's not that I'm planning on being alone, but I might be 30 feet from, you know, a fellow operator. I might be, you know, in a truck and he's out or something. I don't know what's going to happen. I want access to anything that I need to solve problems right now. So I would recommend that you put all of your grenade systems and stuff on the front, unless you're playing some kind of paintball game where you are guaranteed to have somebody within arm's reach of you to get to that kind of equipment on your back. So that, you know, hopefully clears up any questions you have about, you know, grenades being mounted to the back of the vest. All right, guys, that was your tactical tip, and that leads right into this week's topic of discussion. I'm curious to see how much ammo you guys carry when you're playing MagFed. Personally, I carry at least 200 rounds, and that's like bare minimum. I don't typically use a box mag because I'm used to carbine style shooting. I want to reload those magazines. I want to reach here at my side and grab another one. That's just what I'm into. So that being said, when you're talking 9 magazines on your person and 1 in the marker, that's actually a lot of magazines for only 200 rounds would be like a standard hopper. I'm curious to see if you guys are lugging around ammo all the time, or if you're packing light and making your shots count. Go to our Facebook page. It's facebook.com/rat4usa. And let me know.
Hey everybody, thanks for watching. Now remember, Monday Night Paintball is your show. We make it from the content generated from our Facebook page. So if there's anything you'd like to see, just go to facebook.com/rat4usa and let us know. Thanks for watching, and we'll see ya.